Good morning, everyone. It's pretty strange for a kidney specialist to be standing here, which is why they thought they'd get me on first and get me out. What I'm going to do will seem pretty basic, but I don't think that's a bad place to start. You're going to be hearing a lot more, and if what I lay is a bit of a foundation for understanding later, I can't see it as a bad thing. So for people who already understand this, that's great, but for those hearing it for the first time, I hope it helps you be able to frame the questions you would like to ask. I didn't know very much about birdshot except that Annie used to attend or regularly attends the clinic. And when she said, would I do this, I thought it would be helpful for me to know a bit more than the spelling. So I've looked at a bit of it, but I'm not going to say very much more. There are people very much better placed than me to do that. It is rare. It is more common in women. The symptoms include floaters, blurred vision, impaired night vision, and quite a few other things. There is a strong link to the HLA A29, and Annie assures me that many people would already have heard about that, but if you haven't, I'm sure there'll be other talks later to expand on that. It's believed to be due to autoimmunity. We'll talk a bit more about this. You've already heard talk about how the immune system appears to be dysfunctional in it, and this is a cartoon trying to explain these things. So you have your white blood cell called the T cell, which, if you like, is what's going to be your policeman. And then if you have an infected cell containing viruses, the T cell detects those viruses, senses them, identifies the cell as being foe rather than friend, and does things which lead to the death of that infected cell. So that's your natural immune system. Autoimmunity is when, if you look at the bottom half, your T cell looks at a normal cell but gets danger signals, as you've heard, and so therefore identifies as a foe rather than friend and takes it out. So essentially you've got yourself, instead of being tolerant to things which would help you, becoming intolerant to them and damaging them. This is where we then go to mechanisms to suppress the immune system in a bid to stop this from happening. Some of the drugs used for treatment of birdshot include steroids, mycophenolate, azathioprine, and you'd have heard of these under different names, which I've tried to put in brackets. So Cellcept would be part of the mycophenolate spectrum. Then you also would have heard of cyclosporine and tacrolimus, but probably under their trade names. Methotrexate. Some people use agents which inhibit other aspects of the immune system, and this list is not exhaustive at all. I haven't talked about the things which you actually instill into the eye itself, the intraocular treatments. I thought I'd just to help you understand a little bit about why we might run into problems with the medication. So this is that T cell that I was talking about, and up in the corner up there is a cell which is presenting something which the immune system ought to deal with to the T cell. The T cell detects this and sends a message into itself that further stimulates things which go down into the nucleus and produce DNA. The DNA produces a substance called IL-2 or interleukin-2, and this helps you to deal with destroying whatever cells you need. So if you like, it's like somebody ringing the police saying we've got a problem, the police sending a message to the squad room, and then the squad being sent out. That's what you would normally do. With the medication we have, cyclosporine and tacrolimus inhibit a particular step, and that leads to you having fewer bits of the immune system available to cause damage. Azathioprine, mycophenolate, methotrexate, they act on a different part. They stop the DNA being formed, which again affects the immune system and suppresses it. So essentially what we're trying to do is the immune system having been stimulated to suppress its effects. The difficulty, as was alluded to earlier, is that this is like using a blunderbuss rather than a rapier to fight. You take out good guys as well as bad guys. So the side effects of medication, and most of you will know of this, steroids can cause osteoporosis. They can predispose to diabetes. They can cause cataracts. They can cause stretch marks. And at the bottom, you can see they can also cause infections. And this is because they are suppressing the immune system, leaving you open a little to infections. A few of the other drugs, mycophenolate mofetil, one of the more common side effects is to do with the gut. It causes diarrhea and abdominal cramps. And in some people, they've been bad enough that they've had to come off the medication. Tends to cause a low white blood cell count and will also predispose to infections. Azathioprine, which has been around for rather longer than mycophenolate, can also lower the white blood cell count. It can cause infections, but it can also affect the liver function. And your patients on azathioprine would often have regular liver function tests. Cyclosporine and tacrolimus can cause tremors if we don't get the levels right, can predispose to diabetes. They can lead to impaired kidney function, which is perhaps why kidney physicians tend to get involved in people who are on these medications. They can also, by suppressing the immune system, predispose to infections. Methotrexate, one of the others, can cause impaired liver function. It can affect the lungs, can affect the blood count, and also predispose to infections. Question you would then ask is, why would I even be on any of these if all I can see is the side effects? And for most people, there are some side effects which aren't listed. If you read those inserts that come with the drugs, you're scared to take your first pill. It's important that we actually monitor the effects of the drugs. Therapeutic drug monitoring, sometimes this is with a blood test, amongst other things, helps us to detect whether we're giving you too little. So there's a risk of under-treatment with that. It helps us to detect whether we're giving you too much, because that will make you prone to the toxic effects and side effects. It also helps us to individualize therapy. No two people would react the same way to the same drug, and we need to find out what for you is the right dose. But also, these are difficult pills to take most of the time, and some people actually feel better when they don't take them than when they do. So it helps us to monitor compliance with therapy. Is the condition not improving because we're not giving you enough medication, or because you're not actually tolerating or taking the medication you have? I put this up to show you the manifestations of autoimmune diseases, where the immune system turns in on itself. And it can affect the lungs, liver, kidneys, just about any part. The second panel shows you the side effects of the medication, which you'd see is an identical list. So when a patient comes in with impairment of the function of one of these organs, you have to ask yourself, could it be the condition or the treatment for it? Condition can be very difficult to cope with. The treatment can sometimes be worse. So, careful monitoring is needed, and with that, as well as attention to detail, it should end up being a win-win situation. It needs cooperation from all involved, and there are very many different disciplines represented here. Accurate, reliable information is a key part of this, and I put both of those down because what with smartphones and so on, Dr. Google's about the most consulted person. And there's a bit of a difficulty with what you get from there. So it is so important that you are talking to people who know you and can tailor the medication to suit you. Annie sent some specific questions through, and there might be others you have, but I thought I would address those, and then it would be open for people to ask more if they would like to. So when you're taking CellCept or drugs like mycophenolate mofetil, the question was, is there a link between taking this and colitis, which is inflammation of the gut, very often manifesting as pain and diarrhea? CellCept can cause this, but not directly. It can cause you to have diarrhea, but that's not necessarily due to an inflamed gut. However, you will notice I told you that it causes your immune system to be suppressed and makes you prone to infections. There's a particular virus called CMV, or cytomegalovirus, and one of its manifestations is colitis. So if we had somebody on mycophenolate mofetil with quite bad gut symptoms and diarrhea, we would be testing them to see whether they may have contracted CMV, because the treatment for that is very different from carrying on, as it were, with the mycophenolate. So yes, you can be prone, predisposed to colitis, but we would be looking not just at stopping mycophenolate for a period, but actually looking to see whether you may have contracted something else. So that was the first question. Should people taking CellCept be advised to take or be prescribed a magnesium supplement to relieve muscle cramps? I'm not altogether certain why the question was asked, but it's a very specific question. Should I be taking magnesium supplements? And my answer to that was no, only if we've actually documented you've got low magnesium levels, because then we would be replacing something you're deficient in. Magnesium supplements, as some of you might remember with milk of magnesia, can cause diarrhea. So you then get into a situation where we're not sure if it's the supplements you're taking or the drug itself which is the problem. And if your blood magnesium levels are normal, it wouldn't seem, to my mind, prudent to be giving you extra magnesium supplementation. We don't routinely do that. But in people with symptoms, we would check to see whether they have low magnesium levels. A third question. I'm taking quite a high dose of the medication, yet my levels remain low, and this is with regards to tacrolimus or cyclosporine. Why is this? The pharmacist on the panel who would be able to speak in a bit more detail, but I've got a few slides just to help you understand a bit about some vagaries about taking medication. So, essentially, you are with the pills in the stomach. They now need to be absorbed into the bloodstream. If you're taking tablets, they first of all need to be dissolved before they will get absorbed. So in children in particular, and most other people, liquid formulations are given because they are absorbed that much more easily. And if you have a tablet which disperses, again, it increases the chances of it being absorbed. If you've got food in the stomach, it inhibits the rate at which the tablets are absorbed. So at least for quite a few tablets, you are asked to take them on an empty stomach. Not all medication, and very often the pharmacist would let you know what you should do, but you can begin to understand why. If food gets in the way of the tablet being absorbed, it would be better to actually take it when there is no food in the stomach. And some people on tacrolimus, we ask them to take, in fact, most people take it at 10 in the morning and 10 in the evening. You're usually well away from main meals at that stage. But it is rather different with each preparation, so the pharmacists very often give you information about that. Once the drug's been absorbed, it needs to be taken to where it's going to act, and you need a good blood pressure for that. So some people who are quite unwell with low blood pressures in hospital may find that a bit of a problem. It's been absorbed, but the blood pressure is so low, or there just isn't enough blood flow to that organ, and so the medication doesn't get to where it ought to act. Once the drug is in the system, it's then metabolized or broken down. The liver is the main site of doing this, and if you've got liver disease, it can affect the way you handle the drugs, but also genetics come into play. Some people just naturally metabolize drugs quicker, others metabolize them much slower. And as I said, no two patients are the same. You don't know until you start giving the medication how the individual will react to it, which is where working with the doctors and the pharmacist becomes very important. If you're taking other drugs as well, and it is so unusual to find anyone who's taking just the one pill, if you're taking other drugs, they could now interact with each other, either causing it to be metabolized quicker or metabolized slower. the pharmacists and the nursing staff are indispensable, excuse the pun, with regards to this. You really need to be able to know, will what I'm taking affect the other ones I'm taking? So the drug's been absorbed, it's been taken to where it ought to act, it's been broken down, it now needs to be excreted from the body. If you're taking medication twice a day, what we're really saying is that by the time you're taking the second dose, most of the first dose should have gone out of your system. If that doesn't happen, you could end up with accumulation of the drug and accumulation of its side effects. The kidneys are a major source, route for excreting the drugs, but also the liver. So if you've got impaired kidney function, you might find that we're giving you less of a dose of the medication than would be normal, trying to adjust it for the fact it's not cleared as quickly as it should be. So one of the blood tests people tend to have regularly is tests for kidney function and liver function. There are going to be questions from the rest of the panel, but at least for those three that I had, I hope that helps to answer them. And I think, as the first speaker said, for those people living with it, it can be challenging, not just for vision, but also for quality of life. And I just put this down here to let you know that some days, although you may not want to get up and go through the day, motivation, essentially, and I'll show you that in the next slide, sometimes comes from other sources. So when we do the blood test for the blood level, and we say the blood level's low, it could be due to poor absorption, it didn't get to where it ought to go, it's been broken down too quickly, or it's been eliminated too quick. We will need to find out exactly what that is and make adjustments to your pills. So for the person who asked the question, why isn't the level correct? Different factors, and in the same person, it might be different at different times. You do really need to work with the team looking after you to be able to make that happen.